Mosanga is here. Looks like we're also recording for the YouTube Sangha. Very happy to be here with everybody. And we're getting better at making these videos, it seems like. We're learning things, and it feels kind of high tech too, because Yeshi has lots of skills and helping host this group. So it's pretty cool. Very grateful. So going back to this song of Mahamudra, I think Goku volunteered to sing it for us. Just kidding. So, cut the root of the vine that chokes the tree, and its clinging tendrils wither away entirely. So, this for me speaks to the blessings. When we rest in awareness, it's called she, because it's the basis. Alaya Vijnan is also known as the sort of storehouse, base consciousness. So when we abide in the very basis, which is cognizance itself, cognizance permeates everything. It's like once you've realized water and wetness, it doesn't matter if you become coffee, because you know the basis, which is water. It doesn't matter if you become orange juice or mixed with alcohol. It's still, you're at the very basis, which is the water itself. So no matter how it's colored, then in regards to mind, it cannot affect that basis. So cut the root of the vine. And that's why they have these blessings, like things that we call blessings, but you can also call it, if you want to assign a scientific name to it, you can call it the equalization of neuroplasticity. Happens when you get cut to the very root, which is cognizance itself. So the tendrils are all these little habits and things that fall away because you're at the basis itself. A very powerful line right there. So sever the conventionally grasping mind, and all bondage and desperation dissolve. And thankfully we have some meditations here that we do, and also through dream yoga you can discover what grasping feels like, even at the most subtle levels. Those of you who haven't done our little grasping meditation, if you simply keep your eyes open, resting like this for a moment, and then while keeping your eyes relaxed, just pick an object that's in your periphery. I'm going to pick a headlamp. Now close your eyes. Release your object. And open your eyes. There's a subtle grasping towards your object, isn't there? The mind kind of leans back towards your object. That subtle grasping is very similar to what happens when you're lucid dreaming. Images start to come. If you think about the image, then your dream starts changing. But you can also leave the images alone, and you start entering a more subtle part of your mind then. And so that subtle grasping, you can begin to notice that when you're lucid dreaming. But also in daily activity. So more coarse grasping would be, well, when we desire something, maybe really desire certain foods or cigarettes or alcohol or anything like that. Well, there you can feel grasping if it forms into addiction at a very coarse level. So very apparent. So see, we have grasping on a spectrum here, from very subtle to very apparent. Okay, so I'll continue reading here. The illumination from an oil lamp lights the room instantly, even if it has been dark for eons. Mind is boundless radiance. How can the slightest darkness remain in the room of daily perception? So again, you know, this talks about how awareness can, that's why they consider Buddhahood in one lifetime. It's extremely powerful. It expedites the liberation of mental habitual tendencies, mental emotional habitual tendencies. So, if you remain in that, there's really no turning back. So, continuing on. But one who clings to mental processes cannot awaken to the radiance of mind. Strenuously seeking truth by investigation and concentration, one will never appreciate the unthinkable simplicity and bliss that abide at the core. So again, kind of like I mentioned, the basis, well, here they say the core, nice word, that could be synonymous for that basis. To me, this is kind of good news for a yogi, because your mental processes, being stuck in your thinking, is really the main hindrance, grasping to these thoughts that pull you away from pure presence. And we may have emotional or bodily sensations, or the sense world triggers thoughts. So we have thoughts about our emotions. Then we begin to contrive something about our energetic emotional state, right? And then we perpetuate it kind of artificially. So it's very tricky. You start to discover a stubbornness. Maybe at first you're totally innocent, right? You're oblivious like a child would be, and you're in the eggshells of your thinking mind, and it's fine. It's comfortable there. It doesn't feel scary. Even though that whole scary world is out there, you're stuck in your little belief systems and your ideas that make it comfy. But if you discover a meditation path, an authentic one, that leads to liberation, well, there comes a point where you start to see your own stubbornness to continue just being stuck in thoughts or perpetuating a certain emotion, even though you know you could let it go. And we start to make that conscious kind of choice to let it go then. And because you have a more spacious mind, that thought that used to pull you into some kind of disturbances, some kind of suffering, now you're like, oh, I want to be mad, but I'm just going to let it go. And then what do you have as a result? You have this simplicity and bliss. unsought, uncreated. It's there because you let the thought come and go. And like I said, I've been lately advising people, if you have trouble with somebody, just wish them liberation and leave it at that. Don't even think about it. You know, what's going on with the situation? Why are they mad at me? Am I a bad person because of these particular issues? No need to analyze all that. You know, if you're bold enough, if you can walk through your stubbornness, then just wish them liberation and be on with your life. Embrace that peace that comes with dropping it. So to uncover this fertile ground, cut through the roots of complexity with the sharp gaze of naked awareness, remaining entirely at peace, transparent, and content. So that reminds me of Trecho, right? To cut through. And, you know, it's only uncovering what we've just talked about. Cut through the roots of complexity, that basically you're overthinking, proliferating, ruminating, overanalyzing mind, when awareness starts to liberate the very thoughts that create your cycling. Like we found out through modern psychology, most of our thoughts are repetitive, so it's very cyclic. This is also useful for a yogi. So, of course, you recognize naked awareness in Dzogchen, you familiarize with it, and then it gets to the point where you know your thoughts. Like throughout the day today, you should have a pretty good idea of what kind of thoughts rolled around in your head, and what kind of feelings too. You may even get it down to how your body was feeling at different points throughout the day. So anyway, we'll continue. You need not expend great effort nor store up extensive spiritual power. This speaks to the ease and grace of Dzogchen Mahamudra. So it says, remain in the flow of sheer awareness. And at first, we've seen that that's kind of tricky. You have to familiarize the group. This group is very, very good for helping you stay with awareness. Other groups are good too, right? Wherever you can find Dzogchen and familiarize, this would be very good. So Mahamudra neither accepts nor rejects any current of energy, internal or external. Now, this goes back to being kind of radical about allowing everything. If you get angry, if you know, you may have gotten angry, somebody may be trying to make you angry, and we start to see it as all kind of a play and energy. Since the ground consciousness, going back to the basis here, or people also call that the ground consciousness, is never born into any realm of being. Nothing can add to or subtract from it. Nothing can obstruct or stain it. And I think you guys all are understanding that by now. Just compare it to space. Even the hottest fires and the biggest bombs leave space unaffected. Well, in the same way, you know, in a dream too, you can dream of hell, you can dream of heaven, but mind itself is unchanged by any of that. So just like that, your awareness nature, your luminous cognizance that's present here now, you cannot subtract it, you can't add it. That would be a huge fallacy in Buddha Dharma if you were able to create the enlightened mind. If you were able to fabricate it, that would be a contradiction. So when awareness rests here, the appearance of division and conflict disappears into original reality. The twin emotions of anxiety and arrogance vanish into the void from which they came. Yeah, self-liberation there. And as we see, anxiety and arrogance start with a thought. That's where this cognitive behavioral therapy and self-directed neuroplasticity, I think we also have emotional plasticity. They're starting to deal with that in science as well. But most of all, consciousness plasticity. So all of it can be kind of imprinted in, to begin to be cyclic. Yeah. So supreme knowing knows no separate subject or object. Supreme action acts resourcefully without any array of instruments. Supreme attainment attains the goal without past, future, or present. And that's sometimes known as the fourth time, beyond past, present, or future. That's why sometimes you'll hear me say presence. Presence being one of the four samayas, which I think all four samayas we can find here in this text. They talk about a womb of oneness, oneness being one of the four samayas, and then spaciousness and ineffability as well. So we have them all kind of here. And the fourth time, which all times are within the fourth time, would be pure presence. So the dedicated practitioner experiences the spiritual way as a turbulent mountain stream, tumbling dangerously among boulders. Yeah, this is common, right? Especially in Vajrayana and in the Dzogchen environment. It's even in other spiritualities with the dark night of the soul, you have to kind of go through this gate, which you came in, as I call it sometimes. The desires, you have to deal with all your anger, your pride, your jealousy, whatever it is that really kind of brought you into suffering in the first place. You confront that now on a different level, but you have to see that part of you. It may not be very nice to witness that because you start to rest in awareness, and then, well, when you're resting in awareness and you have this beautiful mind that's accessible to you, but you still end up going back to your one of your old habits, it's kind of discouraging. You know, it's kind of like, wow, I felt so free, and then all of a sudden, here I am doing the silly stuff. But you have to be satisfied. Just knowing is enough, and you are aware. And these are the boulders. But like it's saying here, when your familiarization grows stronger, it says when maturity is reached, the river flows smoothly and patiently with a powerful sweep of the Ganges. So that shows that, you know, although your path was rough at first, now you have a very sort of humble but powerful mind. It's no longer so disturbed by those things. So emptying into the ocean of Mahamudra, the water becomes ever-expanding light that pours into great clear light without direction, destination, division, distinction, or description, or development, or any more D's we can add in there. All right. Well, I believe that's the end. Thanks again to Lex Hickson, I think it was, the translator here. And thank you all who in the Mo Sangha and on YouTube who joined me going over that. That was a fun little text to breeze through. And hopefully my explanations will benefit. Add some nuance to this stuff for you, and maybe even draw some connections together for you.